Well, Pastor Jerry, there are a lot of stories in the Bible about when Jesus goes and visits the disciples and many other people within the community after he's risen. And there's one story in the Bible that we want to read today that happens right after the Road to Emmaus story, where as those gentlemen finish their journey and they meet up with the rest of the disciples in Jerusalem, and then this happens as they all gather together collectively as the 12. Hear these words from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 36 and following. As they were saying this, Jesus himself stood among them, but they were startled and frightened and supposed that they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do questions rise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet? That it is myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit has not flesh and bones as you see that I have." And while they still disbelieved for joy and wondered, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and he ate it before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then they opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that the repentance and forgiveness of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses to these things." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Well, consider what you might do if one Saturday afternoon your doorbell suddenly rang. And lurching out of your armchair, you shuffled to the door and opened the door in your shock and amazement to discover that you're confronted with glaring lights and video cameras and a guy holding an oversized check for $10 million. And against all odds, you've won the sweepstakes, the lottery, the big cash giveaway. What do you think might be your first reaction? The film shot of most of these big winners usually shows them with their mouths and their eyes wide open, dancing around while screaming, "I don't believe it, I don't believe it." There's actually two conflicting emotions that race through their systems at the same time. First, their disbelief that stems from the rationale that nobody ever wins these things and that the odds of winning them are astronomical. But couple that with a second emotion of unbridled joy. Yes, yes, this has really happened to me. My life has changed. My life has changed forever. You see, sweepstakes winners are probably our best current example of how people react and look when they disbelieve for joy. Now, Luke's description of the reaction of Jesus' disciples, displayed when the risen Christ at last appeared before them, is perfect. It says in the scripture that Mark read for us today, they disbelieved for joy. When Jesus died on the cruel cross, they had sealed away all their hopes in his lonely tomb. And perhaps in their depths, they still heard Jesus' words about his death and his resurrection. But like winning a big lottery jackpot, the chances of such a miracle actually occurring, while perhaps one in an eternity, still wasn't there just this one chance. And as Jesus suddenly stood in the midst, the fear and denial that first seized the disciples' minds and hearts was tinged with that 10 million to 1 hope. And as Jesus spoke to them, that tiny flicker of faith suddenly erupted into joy. Joy unlocked, joy unexpected, slowly spread out over their hearts and consumed their whole being. The miracle of the resurrection had happened. And the proof stood before them calmly eating a fish. Well, When was the last time that you can recall being consumed with overwhelming, unexpected joy? By its very nature, we don't expect to encounter such joyfulness in our lives on a regular basis, especially during these difficult and challenging times due to the coronavirus. It's difficult for most of us to even conceive of encountering joyfulness in our lives today. Amidst the daily tally of coronavirus-related deaths and the stay-at-home, social distance, mask and glove lifestyle changes that we've had to endure, where is the joy? For many of us, we disbelieve that joy is even possible in these disease times we now live. Unqualified, unbridled joy now? Are you kidding? Well, surprise. Surprise. According to our liturgical tradition in the church, this third Sunday of Easter is known as Jubilate Sunday, Joyous Sunday. This is the encore day that the church has set aside to allow itself to be surprised all over again by the joyous news of Jesus' resurrection. This Sunday gleans its name from the first word of Psalm 65, as written in the Latin Vulgate Bible. For centuries, the church has used Psalm 65 as the introit to this Sunday's worship. Jubilate, be joyous. This is the day of unexpected joy. Now let's tell the truth. When we consider all the possible places we might find ourselves surprised by joy and disbelieving for joy, is the church the first place we think of? Perhaps we hope to encounter joy at some special family function, or in this day and age, a Zoom or a FaceTime conversation. Or when the day comes that we can see old friends, that would be joyful. Or by catching sight of a beautiful sunset. But participating in a church service, whether in the pew or online, probably isn't our first pick of potentially joyful moments of life. And that's our own fault. That is our own fault. The church should be the place where we expect to be shaken by the Spirit and tickled to our toes by the power of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But the church has allowed itself to become stodgy instead of scintillating, cerebral instead of celebratory, and respectable instead of rambunctious. We've trudged along the well-worn path of predictability for so long that the church is operating with a dangerously high delight deficit. And now, in these times of displacement, of disease and death, we're bombarded with everything coronavirus. 3 out of 4 news stories are pandemic-related, and it's difficult to get away from the seriousness of the pandemic and what is happening in our lives. And I'm not downplaying in any way the gravity of our situation. This virus has grabbed hold of our lives and has stubbornly held on. But what I am saying is that there is no better time than now, perhaps especially now, for the church to take its delight deficit just as seriously. If this deficit is the legacy we pass on to future generations, we can be sure that each year our congregation will grow smaller and stingy and sour, with or without the coronavirus. As Christians, a number of us feel duty-bound to spend our time talking about judgment, injustice, or the current affairs. And all these things have their place. But where is the joy? Where are the dialogues on delight and joy? You know, in Matthew 25, 21, the well-pleased master congratulates his faithful servant by proclaiming, "Well done. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Enter into the joy of your master. You see, being joyful is not some silly sentiment that serious Christians should disdain. Taking delight in life, living life to its fullest, is in fact what God intends for people of faith to do. Business consultant and futurist Tom Peters, a number of years ago, wrote a book called The Pursuit of Wow, Every Person's Guide to Topsy-Turvy Times. And he addresses experiencing wow in the topsy-turvy times like we are presently in. And he argues that corporations of the future will need to exhibit an attitude toward life that he calls wow. Wow is releasing and unleashing the energies of the universe in one's life. Wow is service with soul. And wow is experiencing life to its fullest and living full throttle. Now, I don't think resurrection Christians should count their blessings so much as count their wows. We have so many reasons to be thankful. And a little wow in our lives can change our daily perceptions. R. Scott Colgrazer, the pastor of the largest Disciples of Christ church in our country, writes that Jesus, too, lived with wow. His wow revealed a good news God, not a bad news God. His wow revealed a God ready to love, not ready to push away. His wow revealed a God who picks people up after they make mistakes, not a God who pushes their noses in their mistakes. The God of Jesus is a wow God of acceptance, not a woe God of fear. And that's the wow of the essence of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Even the cruelty of a Roman cross couldn't stop the Jesus wow from filling the world. Colgrazer says he wowed them even more by coming back to life through his resurrection, living through his disciples, and living even today as we feel his presence in our lives. When Jesus emerged from the baptismal waters, the Father's voice proclaimed, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." But actually, the best translation of the Greek here is, "This is my beloved Son who brings me great pleasure." Isn't that a marvelous phrase? Jesus delighted the Father. Jesus enabled the divine to feel pleasure, the pleasure of his faithfulness. And you and I were created to experience God's pleasure and to bring God's great pleasure, So why is it that our congregations no longer seem to recognize or register the explosive joy contained in the good news that we're supposed to be preaching to the world? Paul Fries put it this way: "These encrusted souls of ours, like rusted tuning forks, have all but lost the capacity to vibrate to the frequency of delight. They must be cleaned, refreshed, renewed." Delight is another name, he says, for spirituality. You know, we were created to bring God pleasure, to find pleasure in life, and to bring pleasure to others. Look around, and you'll see that life is overflowing with what Howard Hanger of the Jubilee Community calls LPPs, that's Little Pleasure Possibilities. So starting on this Jubilate Sunday, why don't we renew our commitment to creating some of these LPPs, these little pleasure possibilities in the midst of our lives? Yes, we are in a most difficult time. We can't even worship yet in our sanctuary, and we miss it. But at the same time, it is Easter season, and this is also the time we celebrate Christ's resurrection and his conquering of sin and death. And LPPs are one way we can begin to slowly dig our way out of the delight deficit that haunts our churches and hollows out each one of our souls. Unfortunately, the delight deficit throughout our culture, especially now, is so great that it really takes pathetically little effort to inject unexpected joy into our lives and the lives of others. Now, one day, you and I will be standing before God, and we will hear one of two sets of words. The worst thing that we could hear is, "Depart from me. I take no pleasure in you." And the most wonderful thing we could hear that will last for an eternity is, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have brought me great pleasure." Let us pray. God of joy and love, may we experience the wow given to us in the good news of the resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Infiltrate and permeate our souls with your joy and help us to share that joy with others. On this Jubilate Sunday of Easter, may we commit to living our lives in you fully and with passion and caring. Let there be times we're lifted above the fray of everyday struggles, and give us a glimpse of the joy of eternity. And keep us ever faithful to your call on our lives to joyfully do the work of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.